Bringing people and communities together on seclosounds.org.
Welcome to Seclo Sounds and UK Astronomy Programme. This is Steve Whitten. I'm here again, as usual, with Ross Hockham. How are you, Ross?
Very well, very well. Always happy to be here. You know
brilliant.
That.
Yeah, indeed. Good stuff. And again, we've got a special guest with us, which is Dan Brown.
Hello.
Hello.
The Dan Brown.
The Dan Brown. Well, we can see he's the Dan Brown, but...
Did we name him Spaceman Dan?
Spaceman Dan. Okay, interesting. All right.
Well, Tim Peake's got to be a competition then.
Yeah, well...
Yeah. So it's not Dan Brown, the author, but nonetheless, a very important Dan Brown.
Just as amazing, I think.
Yeah, indeed. Well, yet to be seen. We've got a whole show to work that one out. And joining us, as usual, is Meteor Mick. Hi, Meteor Mick.
Hello.
Oh, there he is. Look, in the background, he's doing all the techie bit as usual. Now, this week, we're talking about Pluto. Why are we talking about Pluto, Ross? What's the significance of that, then?
Well, a year ago, probably just over, we didn't actually know much about Pluto at all. Mm. Really, a guy found it, what, in 1930, was it? We'll go on to that in a bit.
Yeah.
But from that, the only pictures we really had was people taking pictures from their telescopes from Earth, which was literally just a white dot moving in relation to other white dots, which were stars. So you can tell that it was something moving other than a star. So people thought it was a planet, which it used to be, which we'll go into as well.
Yeah. Talk about why that's not a planet anymore.
Yeah, and then when Hubble went up, it took a picture, and the picture we saw was just a pixelated blob. So we still couldn't really tell what it was or anything like that. But last year, they actually managed to get a spaceship there called New Horizons.
Right.
And it has just opened up our understanding of their Kuiper Belt objects, which I'll explain as well as we go.
Wow.
And yeah, that's some of the most distant, you know, we call them blobs, or bits of rock and ice floating about at the furthest reaches of our solar system.
Yeah, so it literally did open up New Horizons then. Oh, it was very cleverly named, that spaceship. Good.
You're good at this, aren't you?
Well, we do our best. We do our best. So what we're going to do, we have a talk about Pluto then, and why it was downgraded. We'll have a little bit of a chat about that. And talk about the New Horizons journey out that way and what's come back and all the bits and pieces. You say that's a year since that happened.
I think it was last year, wasn't it?
Last year.
Well, it's now August 2016, so we're talking August 2015 that happened. Brilliant. Okay. Cool. Well, let's have a little bit of music to kick us off with then, and we'll be back in a few minutes.
Take your dad.
So, Ross, welcome back. Here we are on Seclo Sounds. This is UK Astronomy Show, talking about Pluto this week. And we've established why we're talking about Pluto, because it's a year since the New Horizons spaceship kind of captured some great new images of it. And there must have been a massive team working on that, surely. I mean, we've talked about a few things of what goes on at NASA and stuff. You went up to the Space Center recently, didn't you?
So, I did, yeah. Leicester Space Center. It's great there. I'm not sure they had anything about New Horizons there or Pluto. They did have bits about Pluto there, but I think it's probably so new that they haven't built anything cool to look at.
Right.
So maybe if we go next year and take our junior UK astronomers with us, there might be something there for them to see.
This is changing all the time. So what was the team working on this then, you know, for them to discover all this good stuff?
Well, as you can imagine, it was no mean feat getting there. It's quite a distance.
Was that the mission then to get there?
Yeah, the mission was to get to Pluto, but as they were going to Pluto, they then do other things, and once they're past Pluto, they then
stop off
for a Starbucks, as we said,
yeah,
and things like that. And
other coffee shops are available.
Yes, and they're very nice too. So yeah, anyway, it was launched in 2006, and by 2007 it had reached Jupiter. So that's record time, apparently. It's the quickest spaceship to ever do that. So it was really, really quick. But even then, it took about, within 8 years, it reached Pluto. So even though it's going that quick, still took 8 years to actually get there. So that's
amazing.
Yeah, you can't fathom the distance.
No.
Yet we are still able to kind of see Pluto from Earth as a dot. And even though I know people like to see, you know, the rings of Saturn and things like that, you just think 8 years at the fastest speed we've ever done, and we can still see that object from Earth with a telescope. So it's still quite amazing. So that's a great thing to do. So yeah, it shows how far away it is. The distance does depend on its orbit, because its orbit is actually ecliptical. I think that's the right way to say it.
Is it so elliptical?
Elliptical?
Someone can write in.
Yeah,
I'll tell you what they can do.
Ecliptical.
Yeah, I'm sure it's ecliptical. I've got ecliptical here. If it's wrong, I'm not perfect. No one ever is.
Well, if it's wrong, I'll tell you what they can do. They can tell us on Twitter, at UK Astronomy, or they can go on your Facebook page.
Yes, they can come and tell me off, because, you know, I just come here for fun.
You do this because you love it.
I do. I love it. Yeah, and if people want to correct me, it's great, because I learn.
Yeah,
because that's what we say on the Facebook group. There's never a stupid question. Ask anything you like. If we don't know the answer, someone will, or Google will.
Yeah. So we need to know. First question: is it ecliptical or elliptical?
Yeah. Well, what we do know,
and Dan's a science teacher, and he's shrugging his shoulders. So if he don't know,
I believe it's ecliptical.
Oh right, that's it.
Yeah. So
I've
staked my
staked
reputation.
Staked your claim on it.
Right.
I think ellipse.
I think because an ellipse is the shape, isn't it? An oval shape. Anyway.
Yeah, you're probably right there. So anyway, it's not a perfect circle. That's what we're getting to. So it's gonna, as it goes round, it might be closer or further away depending on where it is in its orbit.
Right.
But they say it's around 4.67 billion miles from Earth, but give or take its orbit. So that's a long way still, 4.67 billion miles, and we did that in 8 years. So I can't do the maths to figure out how fast it was going, but that's pretty fast. So it's an amazing feat on itself, getting a ship not only there, but then sending back these great pictures and HD images and all this data from
amazing.
That distance.
Yeah,
it's just absolutely phenomenal. So yeah, that's the first bit. So that's the
Did it all
horizons.
Go smoothly though, Ross? Because, I mean, you know, there's a lot of time and, you know, things involved there, a lot of opportunity for it to go wrong.
Well, they do. They put a lot of things in place. But they did say that one thing went wrong with it, and it was a computerised system, apparently.
There's a surprise.
Well, it always is, isn't it? A bit of software.
Computer said no.
Mick knows all about that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, he's an IT man, by the way, Mick. If not,
Meteor Mick.
Meteor Mick. So, yeah, it crashed when it was trying to compress data. I'm guessing pictures it took, or, you know, data that it got from the planet. Well, dwarf planet. Can't call it planet.
Oh, right, yeah.
And while it was doing that, it was also trying to load the flyby commands, because it hadn't actually got there yet that NASA had sent it. So it crashed. There was too much going on. But, as you can imagine, they write hundreds and hundreds of procedures, which we can go into on the next bit. So they had something in place ready for if that happened,
right?
And they've worked it all out, but it was a panicky moment, because they're just about to get there. Right, we're going to make you fly past the planet now. Here's the commands. Oh, you've crashed. It might crash into the planet or hit something else or go out the way. So there's a bit of panic there for a moment, but NASA being NASA,
yeah.
They always do.
It's a long way to go, isn't it, to not stop in
time. Well, yeah, 8 years and then, oh, it's crashed.
No, indeed, indeed. Well, at least it proves, if nothing else, that it's male, because it clearly can't multitask.
But we're meant to be good at map reading.
Ah, yeah, true.
But then again, there's not, what do you see? There was Jupiter about 7 years ago. Next stop. Yeah. Not many sights to see on the way.
No, that's right.
Just a lot of space.
Yeah.
But yeah, we can't really fault them for that, can we? They got there, didn't they? They got there.
Well, they got there, they did, indeed. So tell you what, let's have a little bit of music while we have a ponder on all of that, and we'll come back fairly soon and talk. So what I want to know is, how was Pluto first discovered in the first place, and what's the history behind it? Welcome back to UK Astronomy on Seclo Sounds. It's me, Steve Whitten, and I'm here with Ross and a very special guest, Dan, and of course Meteor Mick, who's a regular feature here on the UK Astronomy Show. Now, we're really quite keen now to understand a bit more about Pluto, when it was first discovered, what's the history behind it, all that sort of stuff. So over to you guys, really. You know this stuff. So
yeah, we've got a little bit we can talk about, I think. So it was first discovered by a guy called, I think it's Clyde Tombaugh. We'll go for that. Sounds all right. In 1930. So it was a while ago.
Well, recent, okay.
But yeah. But not as recent. I mean, most have been discovered once the telescope was kind of founded, wasn't it? When telescopes got better. Is it 1600s to 1800s? Things like that. Anyway, 1930 was when Pluto first got seen. And I think he took a couple of pictures for it. And it, as I said before, all he saw was a white dot moving.
Right.
So he was like, well, there's got to be a planet or something like that. So he then figured out that it was actually what they thought then was a planet.
Hmm.
It was the furthest planet they'd ever seen. It was actually the first Kuiper Belt object, which the Kuiper Belt is a region just past Neptune, and it contains comets, asteroids, and now what we say are dwarf planets. But generally, it's really just a massive body of ice and rock.